Hi, I'm Donovan with another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Brendan, and we're going to learn about this research project called Metaparticle. Welcome to the show, Brendan.
Thanks for having me.
So tell me real quick, what do you do here at Microsoft?
So I'm in charge of a bunch of different teams that I would say sort of work on DevOps in Azure.
Okay.
So from containers to more traditional things like the Azure Resource Manager templates, but really focusing on how do people build and deploy their code into Azure.
All right, great. And this Metaparticle, tell me what this is about.
So Metaparticle came about really because I think a lot about the complexity of going from code to cloud, right? There's way too much in the way of tools to learn and different, you know, languages, configuration languages, YAML, all the sort of thing that sort of stand in between you with some code on your computer and a reliable system running on the cloud. And so I think really we need to, as an industry, think about how do we build new tools to reduce that complexity, make it more approachable for people? And Metaparticle is maybe one step down that direction. It's a long way to go, I think.
All right, so is this supposed to be replacing my traditional CI/CD system, or is this something that's going to augment that and make it easier?
I view it more like the inventions of things like object-oriented programming or managed code, right? It's like in a more traditional language, you might have to worry about memory management. In a managed code environment, you've got a garbage collector.
Sure.
It's just sort of trying to simplify things and really focusing on the developer's experience, not necessarily on something like CI/CD that takes you sort of in a production rollout.
Gotcha. So we're talking about more that inner loop, that developer loop that's happening on my dev machine. This
yeah.
is going to make that part of my life easier.
And I think also bringing somebody from writing a computer program that runs on one machine to writing a program that runs on the cloud. I think that's a big hurdle for some people, and that's really what it's focused on, is trying to break down those barriers.
Awesome. So let me see how it works.
Sure. So I'm going to start out here with just showing a really simple JavaScript Node.js server. It just says hello world, and it's going to serve on my local host right now.
Yep.
Right, and so relatively easy for me to run it. It's there, up and running. You see, and you can see the requests down below. There was one that failed while it started to come up, and this is sort of what I would expect a developer, you know, is ready to do. They understand how to write a little bit of code, maybe take a sample off the web, run it on their local machine, and they can access it via HTTP.
Sure.
But then you go, well, okay, I want to take that and I want to package it up and run it on Azure, right? And if I want to do it with containers and I want to do it with Kubernetes, there's suddenly a bunch of tools that you need to learn. Right, you need to learn, how do I use Docker? How do I create a Docker file? How do I use Kubernetes? How do I turn up and, you know, and package my application and deploy it? There's a bunch of different steps, and I think none of them are necessarily really related to your goal, which was, how do I get my code running in the cloud? And so let's take a look at what we do with Metaparticle. So with the Metaparticle instead, here's that same code, but we've augmented it a little bit. One thing you see here is I've pulled in a new library. I've pulled in this Metaparticle library. It's important to point out that Metaparticle is actually a polyglot solution. I'm showing it to you here in Node.js. In a little bit, I'll show it to you in Java, but we've got implementations for Python, for .NET, for Go, for Rust. The community has started to spring up around this to provide a bunch of different implementations in different languages,
okay.
All meant to kind of feel natural inside of that programming language.
Okay.
And so you see that the library that I've pulled in here, and then you see this containerized directive, right? And so this containerized directive has said, okay, I want you to actually take that code that I was running, which is down here, and package it up as a Docker container, publish it to a Docker registry. In this particular case, it's going to run it locally on the machine using Docker. But in later examples, we'll show how you can also then push the code out to a Kubernetes cluster.
Okay.
And so let's take a look at that. So now up here, you can see the Docker build happening. And actually, it's also pushed it up to the registry. And now it's actually the same experience that I had before. I see the logs from the application up and running. But now, if I take a look, I've got a Docker container up and running.
So how did I? So I missed where you actually executed. So do I just do a normal node command?
Correct.
Pointing
yeah,
to
you
the
just
exact
say
same file.
Exact same file. You say node server.js, but the library itself says, ah, you know, I see that you are running this program. I see the request to containerize it. I'm going to package it up as a container, push it to the registry, and then when that container runs, it actually detects that it's running inside a container, skips that whole part, and then just runs your code.
Gotcha.
Right.
Okay.
So like it's sort of this mixed mode where if you run it on your laptop, it packages itself. If you run it inside a container, it runs your application code. Right.
Awesome.
So, and I think that really kind of helps make the experience feel the same, right? Because when you run it, you still get standard out, you
sure.
still get standard in, you still get that sort of like it feels like it's running on your machine, but it's actually been packaged and run inside a container.
Awesome.
Right?
Okay.
So it's really trying to preserve that, like, small steps, right? We want to go from running on your laptop to running in a container on your laptop to running in a container on the cloud and really have it look and feel the same all the way.
Perfect.
Along the way.
So one thing I didn't see you do was, like, you didn't, where's the Docker file, right? Because I
almost, right.
almost feel like I know too much about it.
Right.
And there's
right,
a
right.
lot of black magic.
No, but I think that's really important, actually. And actually, what it does is it does write a Docker file to your file system.
Okay.
And so if you learn about that at some point, or you need to tweak it in some way, or, you know, you're done with this library and you want to just move on, that Docker file is still there. It's something you can build from. And
okay.
I think that's critically important with these systems where you have to be able to, what I say is it's more like, you know, you decide to learn how to mow your own grass. Well, like the first week, maybe you don't do a good job, grass gets a little bit longer, but it's not a catastrophe, right?
Right,
it's not
right.
like jumping out of, I think a lot of these magical systems, it's like jumping out of a plane with no parachute, right?
Gotcha.
That's a bad way to learn.
Sure,
right? You want to
sure.
learn in a sort of easy approach. And so that's what we're really intending to do.
All right.
All of the pieces are there if you start looking for them.
Okay.
But the experience at the top level is also compelling and easy to use.
Awesome.
So, all right. So, and then you can see here, we're hitting that, you know, we're hitting that server just like we were before.
Correct.
All right. And so I'm going to go over to a slightly more complicated demo this time. This time is in Java, and that'll give you sort of a sense for how we're kind of using language level features. So
you're using Maven to build this?
Yeah, we're using Maven to build it now, right? And it's building up a directory. And in the case of Java, the annotations are actually traditional, like, at annotations.
Okay.
Right? So instead of having something that feels like Node, it feels like Java, right?
Sure.
If you're a Java programmer, those annotations are traditional and familiar to you. And you can see, but still, the Docker build is happening. It's actually pushing it up. And now, but what you'll notice here is in that Java directive that I had, I actually asked for 4 replicas. And I asked for it to be deployed to Kubernetes. And so now, instead of just running it in a single container, I've actually deployed 4 versions of the same container up into Kubernetes. These are those replicas that you see right there. You know, web 1, web 2, web 3. You know, these are the hosts. These are the various containers. And in fact, if I run kubectl now, I can see that I've created a load balance service, my web service here,
mm-hmm.
And I've created 4 replicas of that service. So my code is no longer one instance of my code.
Right,
it's
so
now
those
4 different replicas of my code.
Yeah, those annotations would have been actually in my Java classes.
Exactly. Yeah.
Not in my POM file. So was there a different, when I ran Maven, did I just do the normal package? How did it know to go even read those annotations before you fire up my WAR file to go do this?
It's actually the execution of the JAR file. Right? So like it is compiled into the, just like with the Node.js example, when you say Java JAR and you run that Java application on your local machine. It sees those annotations,
sure,
and it packages itself as a container.
I guess I missed that step. I figured you were doing a Maven build, but
the Maven build happens inside that step. Sorry.
Okay, so I missed a step there.
So obviously, when you run that program, if you've made changes to your code, we need to detect those changes and build them into the container.
Okay.
So part of building the container is actually running a Maven build.
I see.
So okay. that you, in order to pick up those changes, you have to have done the build inside the context of the container. Otherwise, they wouldn't be there, right? Otherwise, you'd have a container that was stale, effectively.
Gotcha.
Right?
So it was when I actually executed my jar file that the Maven kicked off
correct.
To go rebuild my image.
Rebuild your image, run the Docker build, deploy it to Kubernetes.
Right, so I would have done a Maven build even before that to build the jar based on my changes.
That's right.
Guys, that's the part
yes.
that was missing.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
again,
yeah.
a little bit more
yeah.
like, I think we jumped a couple steps there. I'm
Maybe.
A developer, I made a change, I set the annotations, I ran Maven, I got my WAR, my jar, whatever it was. I went to execute that, and then that's when the second Maven kicked
yeah.
off to go build my my.
Yeah, or
image.
Actually, I mean, the way I usually do it, I just use Maven exec Java, and it'll just do all that for you.
Gotcha.
You don't
Fair
have
enough.
To do those 2 steps.
But, okay,
you know,
got it.
Either way.
Perfect.
So now, if you look, we have that replicated deployment.
Yep.
And now I can actually jump into my cluster just to show you that it's actually up there and working. And I get a little shell up inside my cluster. And I can do a little for loop. Let's say for. So there's 2 interesting things to note here. One is that you can see that it's moving through a bunch of different hosts.
Yep.
So it's really hitting that load balancer. It's really going between these different replicas. But also interestingly, up here, in my standard out, I'm getting all of those requests.
Yep.
So on my machine, it feels like the process is running on my machine. Standard out is still kicking stuff to my standard out. But actually, it's running up in the cloud in an Azure Container Service cluster, replicated onto Kubernetes, right? So I think, again, you're trying to keep that fidelity of developer experience.
Okay.
And then, of course, also when I leave.
And these are, I'm just assuming, when you went into Kubernetes, you were using ACR, right?
Yeah, you can push it. I mean, you could honestly push it to whatever registry you want. But
and
yeah,
then
you
the annotations also, how do I then auth against my registry? Just curious.
Right now, actually, you have to have pre-authorized Docker. So you have to have run Docker login already.
Okay,
so
got it. Okay.
Probably a little bit. Maybe I should automate that as well. But
no, just curious. I was concerned that there would be credentials in my annotations in my code that I'm going
right,
to commit.
Right. No, it's done. It's expected as a side process somewhere else.
Fair
you
enough.
Already did the login, and
okay.
Docker knows about it.
Understood.
Right.
Okay.
So, and actually, you can see here, I hit Control C on that Java process, and actually, it's tearing down those containers
sure.
in Kubernetes. Right.
Perfect.
So the idea that it really feels like it's running as a program on your machine holds even to control C-ing that program and having the program destroy itself.
Great. So all the kube control that I would have to normally do has all been done for
all
me.
Been done for you.
Exactly.
Right?
I didn't have to learn anything.
Exactly.
I love not having to learn new stuff.
And so then I want to show you this last example over
sure.
here, and I'll give you a little bit of a flavor for those Java annotations that we were talking about.
Okay.
So here you can see, so these are actually the annotations. I have this runtime annotation here
okay.
that describes it. And I have this package annotation that sort of tells you, what repository and what's the jar file I want you to package up.
Okay.
This one's a little bit different, actually, and this is where we start to get into the cloud native stuff a little bit. In this case, we're actually going to do sharding. So in sharding, instead of round robining your requests everywhere, a particular request goes to a particular machine all the time.
Okay.
Right. Different requests will go to different
sure.
machines, but the same request will, and that allows you to do better caching. Mm-hmm. It allows you to have sort of better failure modes. It's a relatively straightforward concept for people to understand, I think, but it's a hard concept potentially to implement.
Okay.
Right? And so Metaparticle here is trying to help you with that implementation.
Awesome.
And in particular, what you're saying here is I want there to be four shards, and I want the sharding pattern to be this, right? So the thing that I want to use as my sharding key is defined by this regular expression.
Okay.
Which in this case is the username.
User, yeah.
Right? And then we give the same containerized directive here. And then everything below that is just a really simple Java web server.
Interesting.
Right?
Okay.
So we'll do the same thing. We're going to kick off that the Maven execution of my class. It's going to kick off an internal build, package itself up as a Docker file. So the build should finish in just a second. You'll
push
see
that to a registry.
Yeah. So you see the Docker build is starting
yep.
now. And now the registry push is happening. I have to admit. I've pushed this image before, and so only the last layer needs
sure.
to be pushed in, so it's pretty quick. And now at this point, it's deploying itself to Kubernetes. And this time, it's actually going to deploy itself. It takes a little bit more time because it's actually deploying those shards, and it's actually waiting for each shard to go healthy. Kubernetes waits for each shard to go healthy before moving on to the next one,
okay.
instead of just sort of saying, give me four all at once.
Right.
But at this point, all four of those shards are set up. And what you can see here is now instead of having one load balancer, I actually have two load balancers, one that's out at the edge, a first layer shard router, which is the thing that takes all the requests and decides which shard to direct traffic to.
Okay.
And then a load balancer that is in front of my application.
Right.
And so it's what's important here is now I'm not just deploying my code. I'm actually deploying some utility classes as well that know how to do this sharding.
Gotcha.
Right. So now you're starting to view containers as libraries that you can kind of link into your application. This generic shard router, I don't know where it came from. But I'm using it, and it works, right? And so I think that's also part of the power, is that it allows us to share our code together.
Okay.
All right, so there's the deployment. There's my code up and running. And you can see all of the pods. There are now all these different containers up and running in my cluster. Now when I jump into that cluster and do the same thing, all right, there we go. We get a command prompt. I can say wget,
you're going to show us the sharding actually happening.
Right. And so now what you're going to see here is if it was load balancing, I would expect my subsequent requests
to come from someone else.
But what you can see here is they're continually going from, from the same request. And if I go in and I change this to, Donovan. Then it's coming from a different request, right?
Keep going. Awesome.
And so I've actually, you can have sort of a rough notion of this is what sharding means, know how to write one regular expression and take advantage of this sort of cloud-native pattern, right,
Very
in your
cool.
existing code and your existing server. And so I think that kind of shows via this annotation that feels natural.
Yes.
Feels like you're a Java programmer, feels like you're a .NET programmer,
right.
whatever else.
Awesome.
So hopefully that gives you a picture for sort of where we're trying to go with Metaparticle. You know, there's a site that describes this, has tutorials, a bunch of tutorials for all the different languages we support. And definitely encourage people to check it out. And also, it's up on GitHub, and we're really trying to build a community around it. Because, as
Perfect.
I said, it's an experiment research project. But I think it's an important part of building a cloud-native set of development tools.
Perfect. So you're accepting pull requests for other languages and things like
Absolutely.
That?
Absolutely. In fact, actually, both the Python and Golang came from community members. That's been
fantastic.
Really great.
That's fantastic. So we are learning all about Metaparticle here on Azure Friday.